So now, Virgil urged me to descend out of the first circle, down to the second, which though it encircles and girdles, less space is a place certainly worse still, causing more pain, more curses, and it's more hurt-filled. There stood King Minos, judge of the sinners, snarling as his eyes lock and center on each one that enters. He hears their line of transgressions at the entrance, and with a whip crack decides and sends them off where his judgment delivers. What I mean is that whenever an evil-born spirit enters and falls forlorn before him in the thrall of these limits, it cannot help itself at all and completely confesses. And that king connoisseur of sinful deeds and transgressions listens and judges which place in hell is right. Then he whips his scaly tail around him as many times as the number of the circle of hell. He then decides this sinner should be confined to spend the rest of time. At any time, thousands upon thousands stand before him. Then one by one they crawl down and present themselves to fortune. They confess, hear their judgment as Minos calls it. Then in the next instant are hurled downward, violently falling. "You there, who come to enjoy this miserable hospitality," said Minos to me when he glanced at me, pausing for a moment all horrid activity of his grand and grisly office of responsibility. "Beware of the means by which you enter this place, and also in whom you place your trust and faith, because don't think you can escape just because the gates are spacious." But Virgil snapped back thus, "Why complain to us? Do not impede or even conceive of getting in the way of his journey this day, for it is fate ordained. It has been willed, where the power is instilled, to fulfill that which is willed, so now just be still." And now I have reached the point of hearing the growing lowing of a multitude of screeching voices. Now I have arrived at the place where I am assailed by weeping and pain cries. I came right into a place where all light is silent, which bucks, strains and bellows with heightened violence, like the sea does when tempests rise and strike it, when winds arriving from opposite tides are fighting. This hurricane of the inferno never calms its assault, but hurls and assaults millions of spirits on through the vault. In pitch blackness, the captive souls roll in this madness, being flung rapidly through the air and smashed upon rocks. And when they are about to drop and hit the ground, the air all around is drowned out with the sound of shrieking, screaming, hoarse with the pain as they curse the divine force for forcing them into this forceful whirlwind and torturing them this way. I was able to order my thoughts and clearly comprehend that into this terribly awful torture and torment were condemned the incredibly many sinners of carnal crimes, who let their lustful desires take charge of their minds. And just as starlings fly on their wings as one, forming giant flocks in the winter months, darting and weaving, their numbers infinite, thus move the sinner's spirits in that wind as dust. It just blasts them here, there, downward, over and upward, and they have not the slightest hope of comfort for eternity. Certainly no hope of unction, not even that their seething pain could show slight reduction. Yet there is another group of shades residing, who gracefully like cranes are flying, slowly, steadily, but plaintively crying. I saw them arriving, making a line across the horizon. Both types of soul are impelled by the stressful wind. After a while I turned to Virgil and said to him, "Master, please tell me then, who are these souls flung about with this black air molesting them?"
"Among the lusty, the first one we see there in the furious gale. I can tell you must be curious as to her tale."
He yelled this.
"She was once empress of a large empire which extended a vast distance. By sensuousness, incestuous, lustful vices, she was so broken and corrupt-minded, she just decided to make incest legalized and thus cover up her own transgressions against moral guidance. Her name was Semiramis, and when her husband Ninus perished, she became empress instead. And when the people revolted, mistakenly thinking she could halt it, she disrobed and vaulted naked onto her balcony to be savagely and fatally assaulted. Those who more calmly fly above like doves died for love. Dido, who committed suicide because she loved. Aeneas, having sworn on Sichaeus' ashes not to love. And there, Cleopatra, for whom lust was love. There Helen of Troy, for whose sake was embroiled a seemingly endless era of terrible toil, and the great Achilles flying above as well, who was ambushed and killed due to love itself. And Helen's abductor Paris is with them, and Isolde's lover Tristan. Virgil named and singled out with his finger as we lingered, more than 1,000 souls whose life for love had been extinguished. After I had listened to my teacher deliver this list of dames and cavaliers, historic figures, overwhelming pity took my attention thither, and I was bewildered. I had a fit of shivers, and I interrupted his flowing by saying, "O poet, I have a desire growing to know them. Those two together there, who seem to be floating with such lightness on the wing in the strongest wind." And he replied then,
"Keep your eyes clear, and thus you can espy when they fly near to us. Divine love leads them, thus beseech them with such, and they will come near and speak with us. Trust."
Within a brief instant the wind shifted, and between us and them diminished the distance. Therefore I addressed them both, "O weary spirits, come speak with us, if no one here forbids it." And just like two doves, inspired and beckoned by desire, with wings open to the highest extension, and obeying instincts their own prime volition connects, fly through the air to rest in the sweetness of the nest. Thus, in this manner they arrive to us next, flying down from the sky where Dido is kept, approaching through the air in that malignant zone, so effectively my affectionate appeal had hit home.
O living soul, so gracious and benign, who goes visiting through this air the shade of wine, we who reside within this blustery wind, who have stained the world with our lustful sin, if the king of the universe were our friend, we would pray to him from now on without end, for peace to be showered on you, for the pity you've shown to us miserable souls in our perverted world. So, whatsoever you need to find out, whatever pleases you to speak of or hear about, is what we will speak and hear when the wind has died down, as it appears to be doing right now. The town where I was born sits down low on the coast, on the river mouth of the Po, where that river descends to its home and comes to peaceful rest with its tributaries in tow. Love, love which pounces on a gentle heart, swiftly grips it and rips it apart, sees the heart of this man who was torn from me and murdered so horribly, it still haunts my dream. Love, love which is so powerful that it's a proven fact, no one beloved can prevent themselves loving back, attacked me with such passion for this man that, as you see, nothing has diminished the attraction. Love was the force that tempted us together, and then it has brought us together to one death, an eternity dwelling with pain when his death awaits the one who extinguished our breath.
As I paused to reflect on the evident depth of torment of these two souls, I bowed my head so low and for such a long time, until the poet beside me said,
"What's on your mind?"
And then, after a time, I spoke and stated, "My goodness, how many knowing gazes, sweet thoughts, what desire and longing state must have led these two to this woeful fate?" Then I turned myself towards them to speak, and I began, "Your agonies are so awfully deep, Francesca, so filled with such maddening grief that they provoked me to compassionate weeping. But tell me, at that deep time of burgeoning emotions and sweet sighs, by what discreet signs did love realize to make you both concede the design of your secret desires?" And she replied,
"No more tender pain exists than to remember a blessed day full of happiness and pleasurable escapades when in misery, as your teacher is well acquainted. Nevertheless, if you truly desire to recognize the earliest root of the fire of that love which conspired to pass between us, I will speak of it like one who speaks while weeping. We were reading together for our pleasure one day the story of Lancelot, how he was swept away and enthralled by love, as the text explained. We were alone in the room and never afraid. We were sitting side by side, and on many occasions, while set on the page, our eyes together came, as steadily the color eventually drained from our faces. But on only one occasion, desire overcame us, when we came to the page which described the moment of the long-craved smile and the passionate kiss which from a noble lover arrived. This one here beside, from whom I'll never be divided, kissed me fully upon my trembling lips, passionately embraced me, caressing my hips. But we read no more of the chapter which was the catalyst of our passions, for my husband caught us in the act and stabbed us." And while Francesca delivered this sorrowful talk, Paolo floated next to her, so distraught with remorse that out of pity I started to feel lightheaded and fall as heavily as a recently dead corpse.